chairman's remarks. What a difference a year can make. Consider the following. In March of 2016, there were still 5 Republican candidates for president. Bernie Sanders had won 15 of 29 Democratic primaries. No one seemed concerned about a possible exit of Great Britain from the European Union, and the Chicago Cubs still have not won a World Series since 1908. How history plays out reminds us how much change can occur in 12 months. And nowhere has change been more dramatic than here in Washington. Unforeseen by most pollsters and pundits, the election of President Trump turned conventional political wisdom on its head and reignited debate on largely stagnant policy issues ranging from trade to tax and immigration reforms. Consequently, if there was ever a time for the U.S. textile industry to fully marshal its resources and decisively engage in Washington, it is now. Thanks to the new Trump policy dynamics, the next 12 months represents the best opportunity in a generation to reorient U.S. manufacturing policy, level the playing field, and usher in a new era of growth for U.S. textile makers. Before delving into policy matters, however, I want to statistically recap how the industry fared in 2016. The numbers. Thanks to a laser-like focus on boosting productivity, flexibility, and innovation, the U.S. textile industry has cemented its position in the global market. In 2016, the value of U.S. man-made fiber and filament, textile and apparel shipments totaled an estimated $74.4 billion, an increase of 11% since 2009. The breakdown of 2016 shipments by industry sector is, as you see on the screen, $30.3 billion of yarn and fabrics, $24 billion of home furnishings, carpet, and non-apparel sewn products, $12.7 billion for apparel, and an estimated $7.4 billion for man-made fibers. Capital expenditures also are healthy. In investments in fiber, yarn, fabric, and other non-apparel textile product manufacturing has climbed from $960 million in 2009 to $1.7 billion in 2015, an increase of 75%. Our sector's supply chain employs 565,000 workers. The 2016 figures include 113,900 jobs in yarn and fabrics, 115,000 jobs in home furnishings, carpet, and non-apparel sewn products, 131,300 jobs in apparel manufacturing, 25,700 jobs in man-made fibers, 126,600 jobs in cotton farming and related industry, and 52,500 jobs in wool growing and related industry. As we examine these employment figures, it is important to note that the heavy job losses incurred because of massive import surges in the 1995 to 2008 timeframe virtually have stopped. Today, like most other U.S. manufacturing sectors, fluctuations in employment figures are generally due to normal business cycles, new investment, or productivity increases. U.S. exports of fiber, yarn, fabric, made-ups, and apparel were $26.3 billion in 2016. Shipments to NAFTA and CAFTA DR countries accounted for 56% of all U.S. textile supply chain exports. The breakdown of exports by sector is as follows. $4 billion in cotton and wool, $4.5 billion in yarns, $8.6 billion in fabrics, $3.6 billion in home furnishings, carpet, and other non-apparel sewn products, and $5.6 billion in apparel. The United States is especially well positioned globally in fiber, yarn, fabric, and non-apparel sewn products markets. It is the world's third largest individual country exporter of these projects in 2015. The most important U.S. export markets by region are $11.5 billion to NAFTA, $3.2 billion to CAFTA DR, $7 billion to Asia, $2.8 billion to Europe, and $1.8 billion to the rest of the world. Focusing solely on America's $13 billion in man-made fiber, yarn, and fabric exports, the countries buying the most products are $4.4 billion to Mexico, $1.6 billion to Canada, $1.3 billion to Honduras, $759 million to China, and $439 million to Dominican Republic. Wrapping up the numbers, the fundamentals for the U.S. textile industry remain sound. This is true even though the U.S. market for textiles and apparel was soft in 2016. For the most part, the sluggishness was due to factors beyond the industry's control, an underperforming U.S. economy, a weak global economy, and disruption within the retail sector as sales shift from brick and mortar outlets to the internet. And I think we're all seeing that every day. With that in mind, with that said, the U.S. textile industry's commitment to capital investment and continued emphasis on quality and innovation make it well positioned to adapt to market changes and take advantage of opportunities as 2017 moves along. Another cause for optimism is President Trump's forceful call to reinvigorate domestic manufacturing. For decades, U.S. policy has undervalued domestic manufacturing's importance to America, and President Trump is right to question whether this has been good for the country. Precisely because they will stimulate manufacturing and kickstart job creation, NCTO enthusiastically endorses President Trump's macro policy objectives of fighting for free but fair trade, enforcing U.S. trade laws, making the U.S. tax code more internationally competitive, cutting unnecessary regulation, revitalizing infrastructure, buying American, ensuring cheap energy, and fixing health care. Drilling down to the details, NCTO agrees with President Trump that U.S. trade policy must be changed to reflect the reality of the 21st century economy for it to truly benefit a broad swath of American society. That is why NCTO supported President Trump's executive action to withdraw the United States from the 12-country Trans-Pacific Partnership, or TPP. Even though NCTO had endorsed the agreement just 1 year earlier. To better understand the rationale behind this strategic repositioning, please recall that NCTO worked tirelessly to persuade the previous administration that TPP should include all provisions necessary to prevent any sudden surge of imports from Vietnam that would be capable of disrupting the U.S. Western Hemisphere textile and apparel supply chain. Indeed, NCTO is grateful to the Obama administration for partnering with the U.S. textile industry on TPP to negotiate. And we negotiated a strong yarn forward rule of origin for the vast majority of products, a reasonable duty phase out 10 to 12 years for most sensitive products, provisions that would have maintained a stable Western Hemisphere production chain, and customs provisions that capture the critical enforcement aspects of previous agreements. Noting that NCTO had leveraged its respective support for TPP in return for the Obama administration securing these vital objectives, it was incumbent upon NCTO to be true to its word and endorse TPP when the Obama administration kept its end of the bargain. The 2016 election of President Trump, however, brought about a dramatic change on trade. President Trump's fundamental opposition to TPP allowed NCTO to revisit its position and communicate to his transition team soon after the election that NCTO supported withdrawal from TPP. Mindful that President Trump also had signaled interest in pursuing individual bilateral free trade agreements with TPP countries, NCTO further communicated opposition to any bilateral free trade agreement with Vietnam because of that country's non-market economy and its demonstrated ability to disrupt the U.S. textile market. Unlike TPP, NCTO strongly supports NAFTA because it is a pillar upon which the U.S. Western Hemisphere supply chain is built. The $11.5 billion combined Mexico and Canada are the United States textile industry's largest export markets. Moreover, Mexico provides a vital garment assembly capacity the United States largely lacks. That said, NCTO agrees with President Trump that NAFTA should be reviewed and can be improved. For example, NAFTA's yarn board rule of origin contains loopholes like tariff preference levels, or TPLs, that benefit third-party countries, such as China, at the expense of the U.S. industry. Closing them would boost U.S. textile production and employment. NCTO also strongly endorses President Trump's call for much tougher trade enforcement. Trade deals grant lucrative duty-free preferences to importers, thereby creating significant enticements for would-be wrongdoers. Stopping custom fraud has the twofold benefit of filling Treasury Department coffers and encouraging more production in the NAFTA and DR-CAFTA regions. Without hesitation, the United States should focus more resources on customs enforcement to aggressively investigate those who purposely undervalue U.S. imports to avoid duties or who illegally circumvent U.S. free trade agreement rules of origin via third country transshipments or through other fraudulent means. In addition, penalties for customs fraud must be certain, swift, and sufficient to deter this harmful illegal activity. Also within the trade enforcement realm, NCTO supports U.S. Commerce Secretary Wilbur Ross's proposal for the U.S. government to self-initiate anti-dumping and countervailing duty cases. Other helpful actions that the U.S. government should take include continued rejection of China's demand to be recognized as a market economy and cracking down on illegal currency undervaluation. One final trade priority is the enactment of the miscellaneous tariff bill. NCTO strongly supports duty relief on manufacturing inputs that are unavailable domestically and do not compete with U.S.-made products. That said, NCTO is concerned that the MTB process is being abused through the filing of hundreds of petitions on finished goods, particularly apparel. On principle, NCTO opposes MTBs on finished goods because they often compete with like products made with U.S. product, with U.S. input. Duty reductions on finished textile items from any source can also undermine U.S. free trade agreements to grant duty relief through a yarn forward rule of origin. Moving on to tax policy, NCTO wholeheartedly agrees that the U.S. tax code is in dire need of reform to make it more competitive internationally. Lowering the corporate rate and allowing the immediate expensing of capital investments would be a significant benefit to NCTO members. NCTO is also carefully studying the border adjustable taxation issue. As a trade association representing U.S. manufacturers and exporters, NCTO is keenly aware that foreign border tax schemes, including tax rebates to offshore competitors who export goods to our market, disadvantage U.S. producers. As such, NCTO is poised to engage congressional leadership when any detailed border adjustable taxation legislation is put forth to thoroughly understand how that proposal may impact the textile industry. NCTO is also pleased with President Trump's initiative to cut unnecessary regulations and is encouraging its members to take advantage of the public comment period that closes on March the 31st. To submit ideas to improve the federal regulatory regime. Rebuilding America's infrastructure is another NCTO priority. Besides boosting U.S. productivity and facilitating commerce, infrastructure is a growing market for textile products such as workwear, geomembranes, filtration systems, and composites for load-bearing systems. Fostering a national culture of innovation is important too. In that regard, NCTO urges President Trump to nurture the Advanced Functional Fabrics of America, or AFOA project. This Defense Department program is matched 3-to-1 with private dollars and tasked with making it easier to develop and commercialize the next generation of high-performance textiles. With respect to government procurement policy, NCTO is proud of its steadfast efforts to defend and strengthen the Berry Amendment. This Buy American provision for the military is an excellent example of how the government and the private sector can work together to the benefit of one another. The U.S. military benefits from guaranteed access to secure U.S. supply lines for thousands of superior, highly advanced products. In return, the domestic textile sector receives $1.5 to $2 billion in annual Defense Department sales that boost U.S. investment and employment. Noting that the Trump administration and Congress appear serious about wanting to buy more made American, NCTO would aggressively work to make sure textiles are included in any effort to enact common sense laws or regulations that would strengthen Buy American requirements applying to infrastructure or other federal spending. As demonstrated by Berry, when the federal government buys American, it is good for the U.S. textile industry and even better for America. Another NCTO priority is ensuring that the U.S. textile industry has uninterrupted access to reasonably priced energy. Most man-made fibers are derivatives of petroleum products. In addition, many textile producers are reliant on natural gas to power manufacturing operations. Noting this, NCTO strongly supports construction of expanded oil and gas pipeline capacity to keep energy prices low. Finally, the U.S. textile industry must acknowledge that its most valuable resource, its workforce, is aging. It's just not in our industry, it's throughout the country. To keep thriving long-term, American textile manufacturing must recruit a new generation of talented chemists, designers, engineers, skilled technicians, and semi-skilled labor. To this end, U.S. companies must continue to forge links with local leaders, schools, and governments, vocational programs, community colleges, universities, and state business lobbies to make sure that the state and federal policy produces a labor pool both adequate in size and well-prepared to succeed in a hyper-competitive global economy. The industry needs to attract America's best and brightest is one reason why NCTO embarked upon the American Textiles We Make Amazing rebranding campaign 2 years ago. I'm pleased to report that it is slowly but surely challenging outdated perceptions of the U.S. textile sector because American textile manufacturers have a great story to tell. Our country's industry is a world-class industry thanks to the leveraging the most cutting-edge production processes, investing in the best machinery, and leading in sustainability and innovation. While 2015 was dedicated to theme and content development, 2016 was all about rollout of the campaign. Earned media highlights include regional stories about U.S.-made Olympic uniform and blankets, a series by NPR, National Public Radio, marketplace program on how trade and technology changed textile manufacturing, and a New York Times feature on the launch of AFOA, Advanced Functional Fabrics of America Institute. Other campaign highlights include the publication of the inaugural edition of Textures, that you'll see them outside the NCTO member magazine. Also, regular PR outreach to selected media, a paid electronic search ad and media advertising campaign, a planned social media campaign on Twitter, Facebook, and LinkedIn, a revitalization of NCTO's membership communication platforms, the weekly textile and news and quarterly NCTO newsletter, a revamped NCTO website, www.nctl.org. Judging by the earned media and social engagement generated by America Textiles, We Make Amazing marketing efforts, more and more people are hearing the good news and viewing the U.S. textile industry in a new light. Although the U.S. textile industry has stabilized its position in the global economy, it cannot afford to rest on its laurels. There will always be intense and sometimes unfair competition from abroad, changing consumer demands and inevitable economic downturns. Again, that is why it is so important for the U.S. textile industry to seize this generational moment to influence federal policies if it wants to usher in a new era of growth. With so much at stake in the next 12 months, I implore members of NCTO and other textile trade associations to stay actively involved in their respective organizations. Moreover, I invite all domestic textile manufacturers who have not been active in Washington, but who are also serious about wanting a seat at the table to change textile policy for the better, to join NCTO. Good policy does not materialize from thin air, and NCTO must be well financed to affect the changes that will give our sector the best chance to build a stable and prosperous future for U.S. textile companies. That's a long way of saying great workers and their families and communities are depending on your involvement and leadership. Before I conclude, I must mention what a wonderful experience it has been for me to work with this outstanding staff here at NCTO. They are truly a remarkable group of individuals, and we should all be very grateful that we have them representing our industry here in Washington. A special thanks to Augie, Sarah, Todd, Rob and Doug, Woody, Hardy, and Jameson. Let's give them a hand. They work amazingly everywhere. It's kind of like we make amazing, but they're amazing. So they're quiet, they move around, but they're pros, and they're making it happen here in Washington. Thank you for the opportunity to serve this great industry as chairman of NCTO for the past year. It has been a privilege. Thank you.